In the USA, we have a government by the people. That means we can decide how much tax we should pay. Let's do that right now. What percent of your earnings should be taken to pay for government services? Here's how you figure that out. After you pay for your housing, utilities, food, clothing, transportation, recreation, healthcare and medical, education, child rearing, and retirement savings, how much should you hold out to pay for the services your government provides? So right now, pick a number, 5%, 20%, 50%, it's up to you. Just select a percent of earnings that you think is fair to you and all taxpayers to keep government running to our satisfaction. Just keep a note in your head of one simple percentage number for your tax obligation goal. Got it? Good. Now I'm going to calculate the amount you actually pay to see if you need to make any adjustments to your government to meet your personal goal. We have to pay federal taxes, but of course we also have to pay city, county, and state taxes. And we're not just obligated to pay what government collects. Sooner or later, we must pay everything government spends. If they borrow, that just means we have to pay it later with interest. So the important number is not the budget or the revenues. Our taxes are based on government spending. Now, I'm going to play with a lot of big numbers, but you don't have to understand or calculate these numbers at all. By the time I'm done, you'll understand your taxes perhaps a little better than you do now. As an example, I'm using a Los Angeles taxpayer, but this is roughly the same for every taxpayer nationwide. In each jurisdiction, like federal, state, or local, I've divided the number of taxpayers by the amount of government spending. So it's very simple. If it was $100 of spending spread among two taxpayers, it would be $50 of taxes and obligations per year. Well, the numbers that government itself provides us tell us that government expenditures per taxpayer for 2013 are right around $27,000. You are on the hook for $27,000 for that year. Government publishes figures on income for per household, and there are about two taxpayers per household, so the income per taxpayer comes to about $22,000. Okay, so do you remember the percent of your income that you selected as your fair tax rate? Here's the actual percent you owe in taxes for 2013. 122% of your earnings must be paid that year to avoid skyrocketing deficits. How did we come up with what seems like an impossible number? We did it with that magical thing called borrowing. Your government borrowed freshly printed, worthless, unbacked paper currency from the privately owned Federal Reserve banking cartel. Your government named you as the debtor without your informed or voluntary consent. Then they took that money and they bought some drones and they shot missiles into Afghanistan's villages and they murdered families while they gathered for their weddings and funerals so that we could install a puppet government so global corporations could plunder all the oil, minerals, and resources from that country. All of that has been reported even by the mainstream corporate-controlled media, so don't tell me I'm making any of that up. So 122% of your income is your actual tax rate if you pay it all this year. It's more if you don't. It's interesting, isn't it? Any portion of the 122% of your income that you don't pay in 2013 taxes, you will have to pay later with interest. If you selfishly keep even 1 cent of your own earnings, you are essentially putting it on a credit card. Oh, now for the bad news. Since your government has been borrowing for a long time, there's a back bill due of $80,000 per taxpayer. It would be wise to send your $80,000 to the Treasury right away. You see, interest and borrowing goes up every year, and this could get away from us. If each taxpayer does not send a gift to the Treasury of $80,000 in 2013, in 2014, you will owe $88,000. In 2015, it will be $100,000, and so on. Our tax obligations are far beyond our gross income, and they are now lurching onto a vertical curve. Ladies and gentlemen, we are cooked. So on your credit card, without your consent, government is lavishly paying for enforcing a global corporatocracy with the United States military as the enforcer, while paying back the retiring baby boomers for what they paid into Social Security, while paying for an exploding demand for welfare, food stamps, family subsidies, housing subsidies, transportation subsidies, unemployment insurance, workman's compensation, Medicare, disability, and Obamacare, and fighting a war on terrorism, a war on drugs, a war on poverty, a war on privacy, a war on dissent, a war on the United States Constitution, and, of course, we have to pay for a few multi-trillion dollar bank bailouts. So government is now very, very expensive. And paying for that costs 122% of your income and rising. No one has a right to borrow money and then arbitrarily name you as the debtor without your expressed consent. To be a true debtor, you have to have voluntarily signed a promissory note under full disclosure, and you must personally receive the loan funds. You have not done that. The people who are authorizing the borrowing are not the people who must pay back. There is a moral hazard here, where we have limited wealth and they are giving us unlimited debt. In various countries, this fiscal insanity has now led to severe austerity, drastic cutbacks of government programs and services, sky-high taxes, massive unemployment, skyrocketing suicides, riots, currency devaluations, runs on the banks, destruction of national sovereignties, and surrender of collateralized natural resources to the International Monetary Fund. One country that didn't suffer from all that is Iceland. Oh, sure, their government borrowed and spent just like everybody else's, but instead of pledging to pay back a bunch of crooked bankers for a bunch of phony money loans on behalf of a corrupt government and volunteering into debt slavery from here to eternity, they did what everyone should be doing. The people of Iceland put the bankers in prison. They let the banks fail. They threw all their corrupt politicians out of office, elected a new government, reformed their currency, and went on about their business in an era of renewed prosperity. The only way Iceland was able to do that is that the people spoke up and demanded those changes. The people of Iceland were angry, were loud, were resolute, and they were unified in that purpose. If we do not do the same, if the perpetrators of this mess are not held to account, it will be you and I paying the price, the full price, with interest. My friends, it is time to make some noise. If you can't think of a course of action, join some group that can help you with that. I'm not prepared to say that the people of Iceland could do something and the people of the United States of America could not.